18th day of June. What am I saying? 18th day of July 2015. And it's, you know, my real focus, my focus I like to put it on. It's the second day of the fifth month on God's holy calendar. I think I got that right. I know we changed, first day yesterday of the fifth month, now the second day. So now we're really counting down toward the first day of the seventh month, the next holy day. And we've got a correspondence course we're going through related to that today. We're the second part. Last week we went through the first part. Today we'll go through more of it. I should say, greetings, happy Sabbath, everyone. Thanks for joining me, those of you who are here, especially those of you who are here with me live, because if you're just watching a recording and I'm about to make a mistake, well, you just watch me make the mistake. But if you're watching live, you know, and you have some brotherly care and love and concern, you can say, God, I see Steve about to make a mistake, or his equipment's having a problem, or this and that, and would you please help him? And, or correct this problem or that problem. Now, I'm having one problem with this virtual studio that we seem to have corrected in the Nightcast profile, but we use a different profile on the Sabbath because we broadcast on a different channel. We're on the Sabbath Service TV channel, the Sabbath.tv channel on the Sabbath. We're on the nightcast.tv channel during the week, on weeknight, Sunday through Thursday night. And I got to go through both of them, and there are the camera shots are a lot of work to do. And to find what one shot can be throwing the whole thing off sometimes and causing something to cycle in there that'll cause like our background to flicker like it does once in a while. Not too bad this morning, though, but it's doing it some from this profile. Anyway, happy Sabbath. Here's what we're going to do. We're going into part two of the correspondence course, and let's just get in there, because this is a real good one. We've got less than 2 months now before Feast of Trumpets. We'll finish this up either next week or the week after that, and then we'll go ahead and start looking at Atonement, because Atonement rolls 5 days after Feast of Trumpets, and then 10 days after that, the Feast of Tabernacles begins. So we'll probably try to get into the correspondence courses on both of those lessons as well. We got through Section E, A through E, last week. Today, we're going to do Sections F and G. And again, you know, the only brother, a male brother, I wanted a man to do this with me, who was willing and able to come through and do the voiceover with the questions for me, was a legally blind fellow who I often have taken to lunch, dinner, and driven around. He can't drive himself, so I've driven him. I drove him to the funeral of the minister who was the minister for about 50 years in Alabama, always the assistant to the lead man in Alabama, but he considered that a very privileged position because that meant he was never rotated somewhere else. Well, they did actually want to rotate him one time, but because of his wife, he couldn't do it. And when they rotated him, he would have been the lead minister wherever he went, but he wasn't after, you know, lead position, and he loved his wife, and she needed to had a health concern that would have made moving difficult for her, extremely difficult. So he turned that down, and then some minister caused him a real problem over him turning that down. But I think God considers his work to be, as I've seen what he did, to be outstanding. And he, having been the assistant to every lead minister in Birmingham, they always took him with him when they were interviewing or visiting potential members, prospective members. And he told me oftentimes the minister would ask, you know, hey, should this person or that person they're visiting, are they ready to start attending services or do they need more time? And whatever Mr. Collins said, the lead minister would always say, okay, then he's going to have to take more time and read this book or that booklet or whatever. Or if Mr. Collins said, I think he's ready to come, the lead minister would say, okay, tell him he can come. And everybody in Alabama knew Robert Collins, just about everybody, because of that. And I was telling you that because Sam Smitherman, the legally blind fellow down in Vance in Tuscaloosa County, knew Mr. Collins from the beginning, early 60s, after Carn Catherwood and Mr. Waterhouse came in for the original baptizing tour. Mr. Collins was one of the first in on that. And then right after that, Sam Smitherman came into the church. And so Robert Collins, along with one of the other ministers, visited Sam. And he knew him well. And when Mr. Collins died, I got word that Sam really wanted to be able to attend that funeral, and nobody wanted to drive down, pick Sam up. It's just a little ways south of here. And I said, give me his address. I went and got him, even though I was conducting the funeral service. I took the time to go get him. We made it back. Just whoosh. The funeral service was a few minutes late, but we had everything else ready to go, and we rolled through it. But anyway, Sam did the voicing again. And I appreciate it because it breaks it up a little bit. And let's go for it. We're into sections F and G of Correspondence Course Lesson 36. It says that incorrectly on that. I wonder if I can correct that real quick, even while we're live. It's Lesson 36. I think what I was thinking when I typed this, it's from the 58-volume lesson. So there we go. We got that corrected already. All right, so it's the Ambassador College Bible Correspondence Course. It's the 1964-65 edition. And it's Lesson 36, and we're beginning in what I'm calling, you know, just labeling the sections that have the questions in it, starting with A. We've gone through A through B, A through E. We're now at Section F. And let me think just a moment. I have to operate three different devices to make this work right. One that rolls the questions. Tom, I got the controller for that right here. I got the controller for the fan. When Tom is asking the questions, I can turn the fan on because room up here gets hot. I turn it off when the microphone's on because you don't want to hear that fan rushing through the microphone. All right, and then what other control do I need? I put this one over here. And then I got the control that zooms Tom in and out. Let's see. Now, when I say Tom, by the way, our avatar is AC Tom. Let me go ahead and bring Tom in on the screen here with us. All right, that's AC Tom right there. And so we'll see Tom's face. We'll hear Sam's voice when the questions are asked. And then we'll zoom out full screen for the for the text as we read the scripture that answers the question. Okay, so let's go full screen on the text here that tells us this is Ambassador College Bible Correspondence Course, Lesson 36 on the Feast of Trumpets, Sections F and G. And this first section is entitled World War. And then Tom, if you're ready, and Sam, let's go for the first question.
F1A, what is the very next thing that will jolt humanity? Revelation 8:13.
The next thing that will jolt humanity? Revelation 8:13, and I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven, saying with a loud voice, "Woe, woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels which are yet to sound." Now, friends, let me just pause and say this. Where we left off in the correspondence course last time, what I should do is go over to another switching layer here and put this up on the screen for a moment. We left off in the seventh seal after the first four trumpets. So on this fifth trumpet, the first woe, and that question's coming up in a moment, is the fifth trumpet and the first woe the same thing? And I'll just go ahead and tell you the answer to that one. Yes, it is, as you can see on the chart here. If you're looking at the right side where it's labeled seventh seal, And then underneath that it says seven trumpets. The seventh seal is seven trumpets. The first four trumpets are the first four winds. And then the last three trumpets, the fifth, sixth, and seventh trumpet, are the three woes that this angel that was flying through the midst of heaven was shouting about with a loud voice. Woe, woe, woe. He's talking about the fifth, the sixth, the seventh trumpets, as you can see there with the five, the sixth, the seven. And this is a chart that I made myself following the advice of Mr. Armstrong saying, students, when you get to something complicated in the Bible, especially in Revelation, he said you need a chart to help you visualize it. So he said, chart or spreadsheet out your things. And Mr. Armstrong was good at doing that. He made many for us. But this one, I didn't see anything that related to these things in a way that related to my mind. And so I just blocked it out just in columns with the, first of all, the first six seals, which each mean one thing, basically. Fourth seal's kind of got several items to it. And then this seventh seal, and then between the sixth and seventh seal, there's the sealing of the 144,000, and before the seventh seal begins, there's a half hour of silence in the heavens, and then the first four trumpets of that seventh seal are the four winds, and then the last three trumpets, the fifth, sixth, seventh trumpet, are the three woes. Woe, woe, woe. All right, so I don't plan to elaborate a whole lot during this correspondence course, but I felt in the beginning, and since we're coming in the middle, hopefully you saw the first part, I thought this might be helpful. So we're going to go back and pick up where we left off. I'm going to read that verse one more time. And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven saying with a loud voice, woe, woe, woe. Hopefully that chart helped you visualize. Oh, yeah, that's trumpet 5, 6, and 7. They are three woes. Trumpet 5 is the first woe, trumpet 6 is the second woe, and trumpet 7 is the third woe. And when the seventh trumpet, when Christ returns and the saints are resurrected, then we see that third woe poured out, not as a physical human being, we see it as a spiritual being. And that third woe will consist of seven, the seven last plagues. So there's your 777. The seventh seal is seven trumpets. The seventh trumpet, the last woe of that seventh trumpet is seven last plagues. All right, and now we're carrying on and back to the question part of this. Oh, let's see what happened here. Oh, okay, I see I'm on the wrong switching bank. Here we go. Let's get back to Tom with the question part, and I hit all the wrong buttons here. Friends, we're doing this live, and so bear with me. I'm doing it live and in a hot room, and once I get the flow of this, I usually get it down pretty good. So here comes the next question, and here's Tom and Sam with that next question.
F1B. Are not these three woes the same as the final three trumpets? Same verse. F2A.
Hold on there, Sam. Get to this one first. Revelation 8:13, same verse. Are not these three woes the same as the final three trumpets? I actually just explained that, but this verse explains it too. And I beheld and heard an angel flying through the midst of heaven saying with a loud voice, woe! Woe, woe to the inhabitants of the earth by reason of the other voices of the trumpet of the three angels, which are yet to sound. And we had just done the first four angels in the previous section, so the next three angels do the fifth, sixth, and seventh trumpet. Comment. Three is God's special number signifying finality. These three woes are the three final major battles ending human civilization. This titanic struggle is to be fought in three stages. Each stage is so horrifying that it is called a woe by Almighty God. Each stage is so destructive that only God will be able to repair the damage men will do to the surface of the earth. As the third stage, or at the third stage, the third woe and last trumpet, men will be saved from extinction only by a miracle from God. If God did not personally intervene in this climatic war, men would destroy the last vestige of human life from the face of the earth. At this point in the correspondence course, there's a photograph. The caption for it reads, "Modern helicopters are heavily armed with air-to-ground and tank rockets, and on maneuvers they look like a swarm of flying insects. These terrifying events make the Feast of Trumpets a solemn day. But to those who have yielded themselves to Almighty God's peaceful government, now it's a time of rejoicing. The wicked world of today will be destroyed, and the peaceful world tomorrow will be established on earth by Jesus Christ."
What is the Bible description of this first woe? Revelation 9:1-12.
Revelation 9:1, "And the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. And verse 2, he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And verse 3, there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth have power. And verse 4, it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. And verse 5, to them it was given that they should not kill them, but that they should be tormented 5 months, and their torment was as the torment of a scorpion when he strikes a man. And verse 6, in those days shall men seek death, and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And verse 7, the shapes of the locust were like unto horses prepared unto battle, and their heads were as it were crowns like gold, and their face were as the faces of men. And verse 8, they had hair as the hair of women, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions, and they had breastplates, as it were, breastplates of iron, and the sound of their wings was as the sound of chariots and many horses running to battle. And verse 10, they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails, and their power was to hurt men 5 months. And verse 11, they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon. Verse 12, one woe is past, and behold, there come two more woes hereafter. There come two woes more hereafter.
F2B, is it the first woe the same as the fifth trumpet? Verse 1.
Okay, thank you, Sam, Tom. And verse 1, Revelation 9, and the fifth angel sounded, and I saw a star fall from heaven unto the earth, and to him was given the key of the bottomless pit. When that fifth angel sounds, yes, it is the beginning of that fifth woe.
F3, does John describe terrifying locusts, grasshoppers, that are used to inflict pain upon men? Revelation 9:3-10.
Okay, thank you again, Sam, Tom. And I hope I said that right about the fifth angel. It's the beginning of the first woe. Doesn't John describe terrifying locusts, grasshoppers, that are used to inflict pain upon men? Verse 3, Revelation 9, and there came out Brother, I hit the wrong button. I'm sorry. Let me see if I can speed this back up to the place it needs to go. Those of you that watch from the archive, well, you won't even hear this. I'll try to edit this out of there. Let's see, not letting me control that for some reason. Goes that way. It doesn't. There we go. Now. Okay. Those of you watching live, please bear with me, and I'll try to get the buttons correct as we go. We were on F3. Here we are. And there came out of the smoke locust upon the earth, and unto them was given power as the scorpions of the earth have power. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. And to them it was given that they should not kill them, but that they should be tormented 5 months. And their torment was as the torment of a scorpion when he strikes a man. And in those days shall men seek death and shall not find it, and shall desire to die, and death shall flee from them. And the shapes of the locust were like unto horses prepared to battle, and on their heads were as it were crowns like gold, and their faces were as the faces of men. And they had their hair as the hair of women, and their teeth were as the teeth of lions, and they had breastplates, as it were breastplates of iron, and the sound of their wings was as the sound of chariots of many horses running to battle, and they had tails like unto scorpions, and there were stings in their tails, and their power was to hurt men 5 months. Now, it seems like I read that already. Comment, maybe it's repeated. Sometimes, of course, we'll do that. Comment, the Apostle John used the symbolic term locust to describe the terrifying war machines that would be invented and used by power-crazed men in this final world war. Notice that these symbolic locusts, or grasshoppers, are driven by men, verse 7. The leaders of the fascist beast power, Nahum 3, verses 17 through 19, and are able to fly, Revelation 9:9. They will make a tremendous noise and are protected by steel armor plating. These super weapons of destruction and world conquest were completely unfamiliar to the Apostle John. He could only describe them in the language of his day. These weapons are now beginning to exist. At the time of the fifth trump and the first woe, it will be plainly evident just what they are and how they will be used.
F4, who is the real leader of this army of super weapon? Verse 11,
Revelation 9, and they had a king over them. I did that again. I'm very sorry. Let me leave that fan on a minute, if you don't mind, while I get back into our place. The question is, who's going to be that leader over them? Who is the real leader of this army of super weapons? Verse 11. And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue his name is Apollyon. Comment, the Hebrew word Abaddon and the Greek word Apollyon both mean destroyer. The leader of this army will be none other than Satan the devil.
F5A, where does this super army with its demon leadership come from? Verses 2 through 3.
Verse 2, and he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit, as the smoke of a great furnace. And the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And verse 3, there came out of the smoke locust upon the earth, and unto them was given power, as the scorpions of the earth have power.
F5B, is this symbolic bottomless pit referred to elsewhere so that we can identify the army which proceeds from it. Revelation 17:8.
The beast that you saw was... Brother, I got to get used to those buttons. Handling it pretty good last week, but I think it wasn't as hot last week as it is this week. But let me just get my brain focused in real tight, and we'll get it. All right, now, I went too far. Okay, we're just about where we needed to be back to. That last one was... I'm going to put these reference numbers on here so it makes it easier to find our place when we get off. Okay, we were just after this one. Who is the real leader of the army of superweapons? We covered that one, F5A. Where does this super army with its demon leadership come from? Verses 2 and 3. And he opened the bottomless pit. Let me start that again with the fan off in case I can edit this for the archive version. Verse 2, and he opened the bottomless pit, and there arose a smoke out of the pit as the smoke of a great furnace, and the sun and the air were darkened by reason of the smoke of the pit. And there came out of the smoke locusts upon the earth, and unto them was given power as the scorpions of the earth have power. And I think Sam read this next question, F5B, is this symbolic bottomless pit referred to elsewhere so that we can identify the army which proceeds from it? Revelation 17, verse 8. Verse 8, the beast that you saw was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit. Let me read that again. The beast that you saw was and is not, and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition, and they that dwell on the earth shall wonder whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world, when they beheld the beast that was and is not and yet is.
See, isn't this super army, the army of the beast, revitalized fascist European army backed by the harlot earth of Satan the devil? Verses 7 through 13.
Revelation 17, and the angel said unto me, wherefore, why did you marvel? I'll tell you the mystery of the woman and of the beast that carries her, which has the 7 heads and 10 horns. The beast that you saw was and is not and shall ascend out of the bottomless pit and go into perdition. And they that dwell on the earth shall wonder whose names were not written in the book of life from the foundation of the world when they behold the beast that was and is not and yet is. And verse 9, here is the mind which has wisdom. The 7 heads are 7 mountains on which the woman sits. And verse 10, there are 7 kings. 5 are fallen. And one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he comes, he must continue a short space. And, brethren, before I go on with verse 11, let me come out of this for a moment. And let's see, we were just describing. And there are 7 kings, 5 are fallen. We've got on the wall here, a chart, or pictures rather, of the 7 kings. And let's zoom in on those. Let's zoom in on just the first 6 of them, because we don't know who the 7th one is yet. But that verse 10 of Revelation 17, I emphasize a lot during the week on the Nightcast program, because we're looking, as we watch news, we're looking for that 7th king to be voted in by 10 rulers, 10 leaders, 10 kings of a rebordered, reshaped United States of Europe. That's, you know, as it comes into play with most likely Assyria being at the top of it, and perhaps that leader, that seventh king, is going to be an Assyrian, a German. And Germany is certainly positioning itself on top with their, he who rules the gold rules. I mean, they've been in a position to lend money to nations that have been in trouble financially, and that they are making the rules for those other nations and getting on top of them because of just the economic situation. But here you've got, these are six of the seven kings. At the time that John, the Apostle John, wrote this, it was totally a future prophecy, and it was written in future perfect tense. It was not present tense, even though he wrote it in a present tense language. He said, there are seven kings. Well, those kings hadn't even been born yet. And he said, five are fallen. So the five that he said are fallen, they hadn't been born yet either. And yet he's saying they're fallen. So he was speaking in a future tense, a future perfect tense that would be, it sounded like it was present tense, but it was only present tense for the time after 1814, after the five kings that had been born and became kings had fallen. And those five were Justinian, Charlemagne. Here he's in this portrait, Charlemagne's being crowned by the Pope, as that's just the Holy Roman Empire. The Pope crowns these kings. The third one's out of place here. Let's go back to that one. And the next one over is Ottoman. The fourth one is Charles V. And then that fifth one, oh, my buttons are out of place. Where's that fifth one? Where did you go, Napoleon? He lost the Battle of Waterloo, and he's hiding his head in the sand somewhere here. Let's see. Here, I've got the button for Waterloo here. He's just the next one over. And after the battle he did in 1814, that ended 1,260 years of continuous reign from 554 A.D. to 1260 to 554. And you come out with 1814 A.D., a 1,260-year continuous reign of the Holy Roman Empire. And that was ended when he lost that battle in 1814. Now, he came back after months of being a fugitive. He did a comeback, and he rounded up an army, and he went to a battle in Waterloo, and he lost that, and that was his final and last battle. That was his last great stand, his great effort. And therefore, when people talk about, well, your Waterloo, you make one last big effort and you lose, well, that becomes your Waterloo. But the Holy Roman Empire ended its 1,260-year continuous reign in 1814 when he lost a previous battle and then was sent off as a fugitive and not recognized as an emperor anymore. But he tried to retake it later at the Battle of Waterloo, and he blew it. But then more than 100 years later, Mussolini comes on the scene, and after he invades Ethiopia, he makes the claim that as Il Duce, he has revived the Holy Roman Empire. And he had a concordant from the Vatican, and that tied the Roman Catholic Church into it. And that made him for 9.5 years, about the same length of time that Napoleon reigned. Napoleon reigned from 1804 to 1814 continuously. Late fall of 1804 to the spring of 1814, about 9.5 years. And Mussolini, same thing. Fall of 1936 to April 28, 1945, he had about 9.5 years that he reigned as the sixth head of the Holy Roman Empire. He was shot along with his mistress and comrades, and they were all hung upside down from the canopy of an Esso gasoline station in Italy. And so the sixth head that arose for a short time from 1936 to 1945 ended another revision, the sixth head of the Holy Roman Empire, which has now put that empire back into a dormant status. It's put it back into the abyss or into the pit, and we are awaiting that seventh and final head to come. And when that head comes, Well, I'm getting ahead of myself with that shot. Let's back out of that one and go to that crown of the Holy Roman Empire. When that seventh one comes, that crown you see in the middle of this slide here, this is an actual picture of the crown of the Holy Roman Empire, and it's being protected in a glass cage in the Royal Treasury in Vienna, Austria. And it's very well protected. Even you might get away with taking a picture of it, which they really don't allow. If they know you're taking a picture, they'll actually confiscate your camera and let you have your camera after they can get the film out or delete all your digital shots of that crown, because they only let the government take pictures of that, but officially. I got away with taking one because I didn't know any better. And when I complained to the guard that sign that says you can't use flash, he says you can't take a picture of that at all. He says you can take pictures of other things in the room, but not that. You can't use flash on the other things in the room. And I misunderstood the sign. I said, well, hey, you can't get a good picture without a flash. And actually, I did get a decent picture. I just took time exposures and held my camera right smack up against the glass. But when this crown is worn, its third and final time, that will be the revision for the last time of the Holy Roman Empire under the seventh head. We don't know who that seventh head is, but where it says in these scriptures we were just reading, verse 10 of Revelation 17, we'll pick back up verse 10 right there. It says, and there are seven kings, five are fallen, and one is, that was future tense, future perfect tense for, or to become present tense during 1936 to 1945. One is, that one is come and gone. So now the reality is, six kings are fallen, but the rest of this verse is still future perfect tense, to be present tense in the future, and one, the other's not yet come, and when he comes, when this becomes present tense, he must continue a short space. And verse 11, the beast that was and is not, even he is the eighth, and he's of the seven, and goeth into perdition. Now, speaking about the false prophet, he's the eighth among them. He's the little horn, but he's the one, the little horn, he crowns these heads of this vast empire of 10 nations joining together that'll become the final revision of the Holy Roman Empire. And verse 12, the 10 horns which you saw are 10 kings, who've received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. They have one mind and shall give their power and strength unto the beast. Now, Brennan, let me see if I have it here. On our studio wall, we've got a graphic picture of the beast that comes up from out of the sea. There's Revelation 13 talks about a beast from out of the sea, and it talks about a beast from the land. And those, here's the beast up that comes up from out of the sea, and it pictures the time order consecutively of the 10 kings that make up the 10 horns on the seventh head. But the unique thing about this land beast, the 10 horns on this seventh head are not consecutive kings. They are concurrent kings. They're all ruling at the same time. And this verse 12 of Revelation 17 says that the 10 horns which you saw are 10 kings who've not received a kingdom as yet. So that means the people we're looking at in world news, they're not these 10 kings, but they receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. So all these 10 kings are going to come up suddenly, it appears to be saying from verse 12 of Revelation 17. And they come up suddenly, they'll give their power to that one dictate, that one emperor who will be the seventh and final head of the Holy Roman Empire. He'll be crowned by the Pope, as the Pope has always done it, like you saw in the portrait of the Pope crowning Charlemagne. He's done that in the last several hundred years in Frankfurt, Germany, in the Kaiser's Hall, the Emperor's Hall, right there in Frankfurt, Germany, up on the second floor of the Romer building. And we'll see the Pope involved in this seventh and final head of the Holy Roman Empire. The Pope will hold the coronation ceremony. He'll crown the seventh and final head, the emperor, the dictate for this 10-region, 10-nation final revision of the Holy Roman Empire. That's the way it's going to work. And that hasn't happened yet. We're waiting. We're watching for that. We're watching for news that will lead up to it and show us that happening. And the events that will lead up into it are explained further in the questions as we go on through this correspondence course. Sorry about that. I got to switch the bank over so the buttons will work correctly. Here we go.
F6. Who is it who will be spared from the attack of the fascist Blitzkrieg? Revelation 9:4.
Revelation 9:4. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass. Who'll be spared from the attack of the fascist Blitzkrieg? Revelation 9:4. That fascist Blitzkrieg will be an attack by Germany as the head of the King of the North, the head of the seventh and final revision of the Holy Roman Empire. And it was commanded them that they should not hurt the grass of the earth, neither any green thing, neither any tree, but only those men which have not the seal of God in their foreheads. Comment: When the whirlwind sneak attack of fascist European armies thunders against their enemies, those who have willingly accepted the seal of God in their foreheads will be protected from the terrors to come. Many modern Israelites who will have been conquered by a German attack, and a limited war only a few years before, will be the slaves of the European beast power, that captivity that Mr. Armstrong spoke about for so long. These people with whom God is pleading, who have been warned of these terrifying days by God's ministers, they've been warned by God's ministers, will be unprotected from the rampant violence of the last world war, which will be known as World War III, unless they willingly accept God's government in their lives and the sign of that government, the seal of God's Holy Spirit. Meanwhile, the hordes of Russia and much of Asia will be preparing to attack fascist Europe and pluck the riches of the revived Roman Empire like a ripe plum. But rather than let the communist obtain the advantage by striking the first blow, the beast will turn to attack them in the full fury of his military might. The beast will not be unobservant that the vast hordes of Asia and Russia are building up an army to attack them. They'll see that, and they're not dull asleep at all. They will, like it says here, they will attack them in the full fury of his military might. They'll turn and attack first. This attack, utilizing all of the terrifying, destructive power the German mind can devise, will be the first woe. And then I've actually already showed you the graphic of the fifth angel being the same as the first woe. It will be the beginning of the final all-out struggle for complete world domination between two hate-blinded rivals. Now the stage is set for the second all-out battle for human domination of the world. The second woe is ready to begin, and the sixth trumpet is ready to sound. And that as we showed you on our chart, brethren, that sixth trumpet is the same as the second woe. It's the pink column over there on the right side. It's got the six in it, and then below that, the number two for the second woe. Note to view a chart titled The First Woe, see the file. Okay, we don't have that here for you, but we got the other slide I just showed you. Now we're going to section 8 entitled Second Woe.
G1 are the sixth angel's trumpet, and the second woe the same. Revelation 9, verses 12 through 13.
One woe is past, verse 12, and behold, three, and behold, there come two more woes hereafter. And verse 13, the sixth angel sounded, and I heard a voice from the four horns of the golden altar, which is before God.
G2, what happens as the sixth trumpet is blown? Revelation 9, verses 14 through 15. G3,
okay,
hold on, Sam.
Hold on. I got our slides out of order somehow here. We're going for G2. Somehow the thing jumped out of place. I probably accidentally fingered the button. Okay, G2. Okay, and what was labeled H here should have been labeled, let me change that, should have been labeled G. Second woe. Okay, so G1 we read. Sam just read G2. What happens as the sixth trumpet is blown? Revelation 9, 14 and 15. Verse 14, saying to the sixth angel which had the trumpet, loose the four angels which are bound in the great river Euphrates. Now we're talking about the sixth trumpet now. And that would be the same as the second woe, saying to the sixth angel which had the trumpet, loose the four angels which are bound in the great river Euphrates. And the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour and a day and a month and a year, for to slay the third part of men.
These four angels been specifically prepared. Verse 15.
Okay, that question kind of clipped a little bit. The question is, why had these four angels been specifically prepared? Verse 15, Revelation 9, and the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour and a day and a month and a year, for to slay the third part of men.
G4, how many people will suffer the torment, torture, and death inflicted by the communist armies as they counteract against the armies and cities of fascist Europe? Verses 15 and 18.
Verse 15, Revelation 9, and the four angels were loosed, which were prepared for an hour and a day and a month and a year, for to slay the third part of men. Verse 18, by these three was the third part of men killed, by the fire and by the smoke and by the brimstone which issued out of their mouths. Comment. It is this wholesale carnage which Jesus Christ's personal intervention must halt. If such battles were permitted to continue, no flesh would be saved alive.
G5. How is the communist armed force described? Verses 16 through 19.
Verse 16, and the number of the army of the horsemen were 200,000, and I heard the number of them. And thus I saw the horses in the vision and them that sat on them. 200,000. So we're talking about 200 million. Verse 17, and thus I saw the horses in the vision and them that sat on them, having breastplates of fire and of jacinth and of brimstone, and the heads of the horses were as the heads of lions, and out of their mouths issued fire and smoke and brimstone. By these three was the third part of men killed, by the fire and by the smoke and by the brimstone which issued out of their mouths. For verse 19, their power is in their mouth and in their tails, for their tails were like unto serpents, and had heads, and with them they do hurt. Comment. Again, the Apostle John can only describe the end time doomsday weapons by comparing them with things familiar to him. As man's technical knowledge mushrooms, he will use the weapons described here.
G6A. What else can we know about the Soviet super army as it attacks the fascist beast power, with millions being slain by the super weapons of nuclear war? How will a man's life be valued? Isaiah 13, verses 12 through 16.
Verse 12, Isaiah 13, I will make a man more precious than fine gold, even a man than the golden wedge of Ophir. Therefore, verse 13, I will shake the heavens and the earth, and shall remove out of her place in the wrath of the eternal Lord of hosts, and in the day of his fierce anger. And verse 14, it shall be as the chaste roe, and as a sheep that no man taketh up. They shall every man turn to his own people, and flee every one into his own land. Everyone, verse 15, that is found shall be thrust through, and everyone that is joined unto them shall fall by the sword. Their children, verse 16, also shall be dashed to pieces before their eyes. Their houses shall be spoiled, and their wives ravished.
G6B, won't this destruction be wrought by the descendants of the Medes, who now are in the communist bloc of nations? Verses 17 through 18.
Verse 17, Isaiah 13, behold, I will stir up the Medes against them, which shall not regard silver, and as for gold, they shall not delight in it. Verse 18, their bows also shall dash the young men to pieces, and they shall have no pity on the fruit of the womb. Their eyes shall not spare children. Comment, Babylon is God's name for this political and religious system that has sprung from the ancient city Babylon and has been perpetrated by Satan in today's modern world.
7a. Isn't Babylon prophesied to fall a second time? Revelation 18, verse 2, and Isaiah 21, verse 9.
Revelation 18, 2, and he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, Babylon the great is fallen, and has become the habitation of devils, and the hold of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. Isaiah 21, verse 9, and behold, here comes a chariot of men with a couple of horsemen. And he answered and said, Babylon is fallen, and all the graven images of her gods, he's broken unto the ground.
7b, how long will the destruction of modern-day Babylon take? Revelation 18, verses 17 through 19.
Verse 17, Revelation 18, for in 1 hour so great riches is come to naught, and every shipmaster and all the company and ships and sailors and as many as trade by sea stood afar off. And verse 18, they cried when they saw the smoke of her burning, saying, what city is like unto this great city? And verse 19, they cast dust on their heads and cried, weeping and wailing, saying, alas, alas, that great city wherein were made riches all that had ships in the sea by reason of her coastlines, or costliness, by reason of her costliness, for in 1 hour she is made desolate. Comment, only in this age of total war and swift destruction could a city so great be reduced to smoke and rubble in 1 hour. Such lightning speed was impossible in ancient times, but today it has become commonplace. compare this section of Revelation 18 with many other passages for a thorough understanding of the calamities that will befall the wicked people of the revived fascist European Roman Empire. Jeremiah 50 verses 9 through 16, 40 through 42, and Jeremiah 51 verses 7 through 11. The fall of ancient Babylon was only the small historic fulfillment of the much greater future end-time destruction, which will befall the modern daughter of that ancient city.
Jesus 8, after the devastating communist counterattack, will men yield to God's government? Revelation 9, verses 20 through 21.
Verse 20, Revelation 9, and the rest of the men which were not killed by these plagues, yet repented not of the works of their hands, that they should not worship devils and idols of gold and silver and brass and stone and of wood, which neither can see nor hear nor walk. Neither repented they of their murders, nor of their sorcerers, or nor of their sorceries, nor of their fornication, nor of their thefts. And there's a photo here in the course. The caption for it reads, "The first atomic bomb, a small firecracker compared to the modern thermonuclear weapons. Hiroshima, a level wasteland, its people scarred for life."
Jesus 9a. Does God still send his faithful messengers before this world to plead with mankind to repent? Revelation 11, verses 3 through 6.
Okay, thank you for that question, Sam. A.C. Tom. Revelation 11, 3, "And I will give power unto my two witnesses, and they shall prophesy 1,260 days, clothed in sackcloth. These are the two olive trees and the two candlesticks standing before the God of the earth." And verse 5, "If any man will hurt them, fire proceeds out of their mouth and devours their enemies. And if any man will hurt them, he must in this manner be killed." These, verse 6, "have power to shut heaven that it rain not in the days of their prophecy, and have power over waters to turn them to blood, and to smite the earth with all plagues as often as they will."
Jesus 9b. "But will men hear and obey these two witnesses, or in a fit of frenzy and rage against God, won't the beast cause them to be put to death?" Verse 7.
Revelation 11, verse 7, "And when they have finished their testimony, the beast that ascendeth out of the bottomless pit shall make war against them, and shall overcome them and kill them."
Jesus 9c. "Where are these witnesses killed?" Verse 8.
Verse 8, Revelation 11, "And their dead bodies shall lie in the street of that great city, of the great city which spiritually is called Sodom and Egypt, where also our Lord was crucified." Comment: Christ was crucified in Jerusalem, which has become as evil as Sodom and Egypt in the sight of God. Jeremiah 23, verse 14.
Jesus 10a. "When the beast has murdered God's two witnesses, what will his subjects do?" Verses 9 through 10.
Revelation 11, verse 9, "And they of the people and kindreds and tongues and nations shall see their dead bodies 3 days and a half, and shall not suffer their bodies to be put in graves." Verse 10, "And they that dwell upon the earth shall rejoice over them and make merry, and shall send gifts one to another, because these two prophets tormented them that dwell on the earth."
Jesus 10b. "Will God, who has the power of life and death, resurrect his witnesses as a sign to their murderers?" Verses 11 through 12.
Verse 11, Revelation 11, "And after 3 days and a half, the Spirit of life from God entered into them, and they stood upon their feet, and great fear fell upon them which saw them." And verse 12, "They heard a great voice from heaven saying unto them, Come up hither! And they ascended up to heaven in a cloud, and their enemies beheld them."
G10C. In addition, won't God cause an earthquake to shake these people from their evil ways? Verse 13.
I love the way you accented that, Sam. Verse 13, Revelation 11. Will God cause an earthquake to shake these people from their evil ways? And the same hour was there a great earthquake, and the tenth part of the city fell. And in the earthquake were slain of men 7,000, and the remnant were affrighted and gave glory to the God of heaven.
G10D. Will all of these events take place during the second woe and the sixth trumpet? Verse 14.
Revelation 11, verse 14. "The second woe is past, and behold, the third woe cometh." Will all these events take place during the second woe and the sixth trumpet? Verse 14, "The second woe is past, and behold, the third woe cometh quickly." In the next section, friends, when we continue, we'll go to section H, which is entitled, "Last Trump Completes Christ's Intervention." And the first question of that section that we'll go to next time is, what happens when the seventh trumpet sounds and the third woe begins? We'll pick up there when we continue next time. Friends, I want to thank you for joining me today here on, I was about to say Nightcast, but I'm sorry, here for the online Sabbath service. I do hope that those of you watching will join me again next time we're on live stream. Will be, God willing, Sunday night with Nightcast, Sunday through Thursday. Now, some of you well know, we missed a couple of nights this past week because Tuesday night, I think it was Tuesday night, there was a big thunderstorm that blew in just at broadcast time. And frankly, brethren, for me, that worked out to be a nice blessing because with all the lights out, now, I still had UPS power, uninterrupted power supply, keeping my modem going. So I was able to communicate with some of you and let you know that we had just had our power knocked out. And I was able to use my little smartphone and, you know, through the modem. The modem was still being powered by the uninterrupted power supply that kept it going for about another hour or so. And then it went out and we were without power through much of the night. And then off and on some of the next day. So we missed that broadcast, but I did that broadcast in the live stream the next night. The news from that day was the important news of the week with what happened out of Greece and the European Union with that big actually the bigger news of that day was deal that the P5 plus one made with Iran, the so-called deal. And then, of course, we saw Prime Minister Netanyahu's reaction, which remained the same. His comments on that day and the news clips from that day were almost identical to what he said 2 years before in 2013. He stays constant. He doesn't change. He sees the problem. Of course, the problem's even gotten worse now with 2 years passing by and the Iran being able to sneakily continue to develop as they bragged about. I provided video from a secret broadcast they did. Actually, they just did it on Syrian television in December 2012, and they did it in the Arabian language, but we were able to get accurate English subtitles for it across the bottom of it so you can read exactly what they were saying. And they were bragging about how they pulled a fast one on the P5 plus one, and how they've been secretly developing more uranium than they're telling about. You know, and why the agencies that do all that snooping on Americans and others, why they didn't get that and pass it on to President Obama, I don't know. Although I have to say to you, I think he probably is aware of what they've said, and he just has a different idea. He's got some kind of blindsided belief inspired in him by the God of this world that, like Hitler, he can, you know, whatever he does is right. Anyway, we'll be back with news Sunday night. Thanks for joining me today for the service and for another section from the correspondence course. Like I said, we'll pick up with this next section entitled The Last Trump Completes Christ's Intervention. We'll pick up with that next Sabbath. And then after we finish the correspondence course on trumpets, we'll try to go on with a course on atonement. If you like Sam reading these questions to help break it up a little bit, let me know. I'll ask him if he'll do another one for us. Or if some of you want to volunteer, some of you fellows out there want to volunteer to read the questions while I try to roll the scriptures after the question and answer them, so you can just watch a video, let me know. I'll be happy to have some help. But friends, that's it for today. God willing and the creek don't rise, we'll see you Sunday night for Nightcast. We'll see you next Sabbath for those that tune in here again on Sabbath.tv. Have a good Sabbath afternoon and a great week. So long till Stephen Lloyd Gilbert saying, so long till next time.